Good afternoon. Thanks for coming down here for our press conference. I'm Sarah Rose. I'm a staff attorney with the ACLU of Pennsylvania. With me today are my co-counsel, Glenn Downey, of the law firm William Hornack, where we are today, and James Love.
Excuse me, before you start, can one more get in here? Sorry.
And of course, Dennis Henderson, which is the reason why we're here today. So we are announcing the filing of a federal lawsuit on behalf of Mr. Henderson, who is a Pittsburgh resident and a teacher, who was stopped by a Pittsburgh police officer for no reason, and then unlawfully arrested and jailed overnight because he had the audacity to question the officer's authority to detain him. We have copies of the complaint and the press release available if anyone needs those. And I'm just going to talk briefly about the case and turn over to Glenn, and then Mr. Henderson's going to talk about his experience. So what happened to Mr. Henderson is a symptom of what we see as a deeper problem of racial profiling and police harassment. Simply being a black man in a black neighborhood does not give police probable cause to stop you, but unfortunately too many of our police officers think that it does. We hope that this case will bring much needed attention to this issue and will motivate the next mayoral administration to take action to stop the indiscriminate stops of law-abiding citizens.
And as Ms. Rose said there, one of the important issues here is that this was, in our view, a racially motivated stop, but there are bigger issues at play here. Most importantly, as you'll hear from Dennis, is that what happened to Dennis shouldn't happen to anybody, and that that needs to be redressed for Dennis's sake. But the bigger picture here is community police relations and how the police effectively serve the community when they become part of the community, and when the community feels that the police are there to help them. And as we see in Pittsburgh often, those two communities don't often relate on the level that we'd like them to. And one of the reasons, apart from having Dennis tell his story to you, is that we want this story to be out there to the public so that the police and the community of Pittsburgh begin to come together and begin to understand how they can work together, not only to solve the problems of crime in the community, but also to understand how each can serve the other in a better way. And so that's really important. We're here to help Dennis, but we also think that Dennis understands that there's a bigger story here, and that story is he doesn't want what happened to him to happen to anybody else.
So I'm just going to ask Dennis to describe the events, and then we will turn it over to you guys for questions. Why did you attend the Community Empowerment Association meeting?
The purpose of attending a meeting that day was to work on an urban agenda, which was to address some of the issues in regards to some of the more at-risk communities, in regards to economic stability, education, and building community relationships with the police department.
What happened when you left the meeting?
When I left the meeting that day, I actually was walking out and I was stopped by a reporter from the Courier who had asked me for my contact information to follow up on the story that he had did earlier this year. I told him I didn't have any information on me and told him that he could follow me out to my car and I'd give him a business card. At the time we had exchanged information, right before we were about to depart, we seen a police car coming and that's where everything started from.
And what happened when you saw the police car?
We seen a police car crossing the intersection. We seen it picking up speed, and we was under the assumption that he was on his way to respond to a call. as the car continued to head towards us, we noticed it continued to veer closer to the right where we were standing near my vehicle, to the point where we had to press ourselves against the car. He made sure that he got close enough that we had to press ourselves against the car to avoid being struck by the vehicle. As soon as he passed us, his speed decreased. You see him hit his brake, and he swerved back out towards the middle of the street again. And that's when it was real obvious that his action was just intended to intimidate us. Shocked by what he did, I did express wow. And at that point, he immediately did a U-turn, came back around, and then confronted us, asking if I had a problem with his driving.
And what was going through your mind when this was happening?
Still shock, but when he posed the question if I had a problem, I did feel that, you know, I had the right to let him know that I did think what he did was inappropriate. And at that time, I had asked him for his name and his badge number. And from there, he got more agitated about me asking for his name and badge number. At that point, he stopped his vehicle in the middle of the road, got out of his vehicle, then demanded the identification of myself and the reporter that was with me. We provided him our IDs, and as he was yelling orders at us, someone else that was walking across the street noticed what was going on and had asked the officer what we had done and why was he responding the way that he was responding. He then told that individual to just keep walking and mind his business. Uncomfortable with the officer and just his whole erratic behavior from the very beginning, I had told the individual that was there, I feel more comfortable if he stayed to just watch what was going on. The officer got even more agitated with me asking the individual to stay to continue to watch. At that point, he had told us to walk up to the curb up on the sidewalk. At that point, that's when I seen him radio for backup. I was extremely uncomfortable with where this whole thing was going. And at that point, I told the officer that I am uncomfortable with this, and from here on out, I'm going to record the rest of our interaction with my cell phone. At that point, he told me I'm not allowed to record him. He attempted to snatch my phone. I refused to give him my phone. And he said, well, then put your hands behind your back. I was in disbelief that he told me to put my hands behind my back because I didn't understand why. And I did ask him why, and he never gave me an answer. He just told me, put my hands behind my back or I'm going to be, you know, considered for resisting arrest. At that point, I passed my phone to the reporter that was next to me and just asked that he just hold on to it. I put my hands behind my back. He bypassed me, went directly to the reporter and handcuffed him. At that point, I'm apologizing to the reporter for putting him in this situation. Still standing there with my hands behind my back. He then came back over to me, twisted my arms behind my back very harshly. And then at that point, told me to sit down on the ground. The way my arm was twisted, I really couldn't move. And I was trying to just get my arm straightened back out. He once again told me if I don't sit down, he's going to put me down. No sooner than he said that, he did sweep me from behind and slam me upon my back. And at that point, I did see other residents that were observing. And from there, I just kind of laid there and just watched and listened as everything else continued to transpire as other cops arrived to the scene.
And the cell phone did end up recording at least the audio of your encounter with Officer Gromek, correct?
Yes.
And so what happened? Did he let you go? Or?
No, he didn't let me go. The reporter and myself, we were both sitting there on the ground. As the other officers came to the scene, I was expecting someone to come and kind of debrief what was going on. There was never much of a debriefing. Someone did recognize the reporter and asked the officer if he knew who the reporter was. The officer said he did not. He then told the officer he's with the media, get him out of the handcuffs, which the officer did immediately. And then he asked the officer what to do with me, and the officer told him to take me in downtown.
Wow. So you went down to the Allegheny County Jail?
Yes.
And how long were you there?
I wound up staying there, got there approximately, I kind of lost track of time, might have been around 7:30, 8 in the evening. And I was released approximately 8:30 the following day in the morning.
And were you charged with anything?
Yes, I was charged with three different charges, obstructing the highway, resisting arrest, and I want to say disorderly conduct, I believe.
What happened to the charges?
Charges were withdrawn from District Attorney Zapala pending a further investigation of the OMI. And since then, I'm still waiting to see if they have been officially dropped.
So did you ever file a complaint about what happened?
Yes, I did. I filed a complaint with the Citizens Review Board and as well as the OMI, the Office of Municipal Investigations.
And do you know what happened with that complaint?
Right now, Citizens Review Board is still ongoing, in which they're about to continue on with their investigation. And OMI did come back with their investigation complete and found Officer Gromek in violation.
So they sustained your allegations against the officer?
Yes, they did.
So how has, you know, this incident affected you and your family?
Just a lot of unwarranted stress, emotionally, physically, you know, just for my wife, myself, my kids, you know, just shouldn't have been no reason that my daughter got an answer to her peers of why her dad was on TV in handcuffs. Just unnecessary for my wife to have to, you know, deal with the stress of not knowing where I was that evening when she was expecting me to be on my way home. To not be able to receive a call or have any information formally sent to her. I mean, she had to find out via the news where I was that night. Other than that, she had no idea what was going on with me because she was expecting me home around 7:30 that evening.
So why did you decide to file this lawsuit?
Primarily, well, two reasons. Primarily because of the injustice that was done to me for no reason whatsoever except being in Homewood, for my family, just the stress that my wife and my children and just those close to me had to deal with just to help us get through the situation. And more importantly, just for the fact it's too common. This is the sad fact, it is too common. And if this could bring light to the situation, that in itself is worth filing this case.
And you're a teacher, correct? And,
yes.
And did you have to address questions to your students about what happened to you, and how did you address those if you did?
I did. One of the big things that I do teach regularly is law-related education. And I'm often telling them how to deal with the police in situations. First day of school coming back this year, got a couple students, they just... Yeah, we did everything that you tell us to do, and you got slammed. It don't work. So it's kind of it makes my job more challenging. And I did have to clarify information for the students. They had a lot of different ideas or misconceptions about what happened. So I, you know, just to kind of make sure that I can maintain my rapport with them and my respect for my students, I did have to make sure that I talked to them and clarify things with them. And hopefully, throughout this whole case, they can see that we do have a process that constitutional rights are upheld.
Is there anything else that you'd like to say?
Yeah, I did want to just make sure that I thank the residents of Homewood today for their vigilance and the members that was in attendance at the Community Empowerment Association for their immediate action on the evening of June 26th. I can't express my appreciation for the journalists and the reporters for the questions and coverage of this story. The overwhelming outreach and supportive prayers from family, friends, students, colleagues, neighbors, and complete strangers. I also want to thank District Attorney Zapala for withdrawing the charges pending the OMI investigation. I'm a proud resident of Pittsburgh, and I just wanted to be known that I'm filing this case because Officer Gromek used his patrol car to intimidate and endanger me for no apparent reason other than being black and Homewood. I'm filing this case because Officer Gromek handcuffed me, slammed me to the ground, and subjected me to being treated as if I committed a crime simply because I attempted to exercise my constitutional rights. For no justifiable reason but to demonstrate his power, Officer Gromek had me locked in a packed cell overnight where I slept on a cement floor in the Allegheny County Jail. For no justifiable reason, the irrational and over-aggressive actions of Officer Gromek placed unwarranted stress on my family, mentally, physically, and emotionally, that still lingers with us today. I've dedicated my career to educating and mentoring young people to rise above their present situations, discover their talents, embrace the Pittsburgh promise, and become productive members of our community. The false arrest of Officer Gromek jeopardized all I've worked for and undermined everything I stand for. I'm filing this case because regardless of the neighborhood, ethnicity, attire, age, or socioeconomic status, no one in Pittsburgh should be harassed, arrested, and placed into the criminal justice system by a police officer who operates under a code of provoking and arresting individuals at their discretion. Unfortunately, much too often, African Americans are profiled and subjected to harassment, intimidation, and false arrest in Pittsburgh and throughout the country. I have a great deal of respect for the men and women who have taken the oath to serve our communities and protect our communities. However, Officer Gromek and officers who abuse their power creates an environment of distrust and complicates the efforts of the police officers that go to work each day to serve and protect our communities with respect and integrity. I hope this lawsuit opens candid dialogue about racial profiling in our region, evoke action for change, and provide compensation for my family and myself due to the actions of Officer Gromek. Thank you.
Anyone has any questions? Now's the time.
Legally, what's the importance, if any, of the existence of a recording, an audio recording of at least parts of this incident?
I think that often when you have a situation where a police officer is accused of excessive force and false arrest, it's often the officer's word against the individual's. Here, the recording gives the public a way to counter what the police officer says. This may have been a very different story if we did not have that recording. And that's one of the reasons why, for the ACLU, it's so important that the police understand that the public has a First Amendment right to record and that they respect that right.
And much too often, as you've seen, this is not the first case that we've raised this issue. And unfortunately, as we know, for everyone like Mr. Henderson here who stands up and continues to record, most people who are told by a police officer that they can no longer record them will in fact turn off their phone, turn off their camera, and stop recording. So it's important when we have those people who stand up that we get the message out there that people do in fact have a right to stand up and record their public officials in public spaces.
How good is the recording? Does it begin? When does it begin?
The recording, it begins at the time that Mr. Henderson says, I'm going to record you, which is after you've been asked for identification, but before he was handcuffed, obviously, because he was able to record, and continues until the backup officers arrive at the scene. So it's face up on the ground, so you don't see very much, but you can hear everything that's going on in this recording.
And how long does it last?
It's about 5 or 6 minutes.
What are you seeking? Damages, compensation, what are you seeking through this lawsuit?
Well, in this kind of a case where the rights have already been violated, the only thing that we can seek from a court is monetary damages. But certainly, Mr. Henderson, the ACLU, my co-counsel, all have an interest in preventing this from happening to other people, preventing this indiscriminate stops and frisks of people, especially African Americans on the street. And so we would welcome an opportunity to discuss with the city ways to stop police officers from doing that. In addition, education about the public's right to record police officers and the exercise of their duties. But all that we can ask a court to award is monetary damages.
Is there a dollar amount you can ask for?
We have not specified a dollar amount. It's up to a jury.
Mr. Henderson, was this life-changing for you?
Yeah. It's life-changing, I mean, just for the fact I worked hard to stay out of the system. To be handcuffed and, you know, arrested for something you don't plan on doing that, you know, or not committing a crime. Yeah, it actually, you know, it makes you look at everything at a different angle. You know, as a teacher, you know, and you're working in the city, you're teaching kids to do certain things, and, you know, the doors and opportunities open up for you. But then you also start seeing things back to, you know, I kind of reverted back to when I was 13 and kind of the lens of what kids see. When they see the city, a lot of times the ambassadors of the city are the police officers. When you have a police officer that kind of treats you that way, it made me see from a broader perspective what our kids are seeing on the street.
As far as your own kids, how old are they? And I mean, did this scare them? And how are they feeling in life generally?
I mean, I have two kids, and I'm proud of both of them. My oldest daughter is the one that probably dealt with the brunt. She's 9 years old, and I have a 3-year-old. She really didn't catch what's going on, but my 9-year-old, she did, you know, at camp the next day, people saying, yeah, your dad's in jail, you know, things kids do, you know. And my daughter had a lot of questions, and, you know, just sit down and have to talk to her about that, you know, it's something you don't want to do. But then at the same time, I wanted to make sure my daughter do understand, no, your daddy's not a bad person, and, you know, he didn't do anything wrong.
Given OMI's findings in this case, was there any effort by the city to contact you and make some type of monetary settlement prior to the filing of a lawsuit?
No, I haven't heard anything.
Do you know the status of Officer Gromek?
We don't know.
You do not know at this point.
Would you like to see him removed from the force?
I don't want to see him on the streets.
I don't remember. What school do you teach at and what grade are your students?
Manchester Academic Charter School, middle school 6, 7, and 8.
What impression do you have of the OMI process and where it's led, which apparently is to an assignment to the warrant office for Officer Gromek at this point?
I mean, I think their investigation was objective and complete. I think they was just very fair about things. I'm pleased with the result of the investigation. Short to that end, investigation.
Did anyone from the city ever apologize to you?
No.
Why didn't you sue the city as Jordan Miles did, for instance, initially? Why only the officer in this case?
So at this point, we're exploring whether any higher-up should be named, but just for strategic reasons, we've named the officer.
The city would have liability for the officer, or no?
There's a possibility there, but we're still exploring.
If you're asking it in terms of if there are damages, would it come from the officer, or would it come from the city? The answer is going to be it's going to come from the city. The city, you know, city's self-insured.
Yeah.
But it would come from the city itself and not from Officer Gromek's pocket, if that was the question.
Yeah.
What is the officer's first name?
Jonathan.
Have you all had any contact with Mr. Stewart throughout this process, or do you expect him to play any role as the suit moves forward?
Well, he's certainly a witness to what happened, so I'm sure that you know, if we get to discovery, he's going to be called on to describe what happened.
And any contact with him throughout this? Has he mentioned anything about, you know, what he would like to see done from his perspective? I don't know how much communication you guys have been in with him.
Yeah, we haven't really spoken with him.
So all the charges were dropped. Was your name cleared? Your record cleared? Or whenever someone Googles your name or goes on a website and finds your name, their charges still going to be on there?
As of right now, the charges haven't been formally dropped. Last I know, they were withdrawn pending the investigation. I don't know exactly where things stand right now. I haven't had anything formally expunged or anything like that. So at this moment, yes, I do still have the charges on my record, I'm pretty sure.
In Pennsylvania, you know, Mr. Henderson will be entitled to a full expungement through this process because the charges have been withdrawn and there was no finding. So even that arrest record, at some point he will be entitled to an expungement of that. But as you know, in today's world, an expungement means something very different than it did 20 years ago, because just because it's taken out of the state system or the county system doesn't mean that it's not going to show up for him in future employment opportunities. And that's the unfortunate part here. This will stay with him, not just emotionally and physically, but even something as simple as that, even though he's entitled to an expungement, there's no way anybody can guarantee a full expungement in today's electronic world.
You said at some point in the state of PA, it's like 7 years. So does he have to wait 7 years for that
this
point?
This is for an arrest. You can try to get the arrest record expunged right away.
As soon as you're found, you're acquitted of the charges, charges are withdrawn, dismissed, you are entitled to file expungement paperwork with the county of Allegheny here.
So it's different. I think the 7 years is if you've been convicted.
If you're convicted of a summary charge under statute in Pennsylvania, you have 5 years. Here, there's no conviction. Obviously, he's entitled to that expungement whenever he chooses to file that paperwork.
And just to clarify, so the district attorney announced in July that he would withdraw the charges pending the outcome of the OMI investigation. The district attorney would have to refile those charges for them to be back in play, and we certainly do not expect that to happen, especially given the outcome of the OMI investigation. So at this point, we consider the charges to have been dropped, and that Mr. Henderson is eligible to seek an expungement of that arrest.
Both the lawsuit and Mr. Henderson, you mentioned this earlier, that there was a racial dimension to this. I'm wondering what evidence there was, if there were, you know, elements of Officer Gromek's behavior that suggested that, or just where that comes from.
His whole approach, just unprovoked. If it wasn't racial, I have no idea what it was then. But just to, for no apparent reason whatsoever, to use your car to kind of just play chicken with someone's person, for no reason whatsoever. I don't know any other reason aside from being a black man talking to another black man in Homewood. I don't know if that's a normal practice in Squirrel Hill or anywhere else, but he was very casual about what he did there.
And as we see, it turned from that initial, we think, racially profiled stop to what we consider a contempt of cop case, right, where he questioned the officer's ability to drive like that down a residential street, and then also when he begins to record him, the anxiety ramps up from the officer. So those are things we see across the racial spectrum, but it seems to us this initial stop where two black men standing on the street in Homewood, a police car intentionally veers towards them. It's no question in their mind. They had to move up against the car to simply get out of the officer's way as he drove fairly fast down a residential street without his lights on, no indication that he was actually going to some sort of emergency call at that point.
Have you developed any information on the officer's prior history, and is it relevant here?
Prior history is relevant, but we will be getting that information in discovery.
One of you had mentioned that you might be open to meeting with somebody in the city to discuss different issues about recording and possibly racial profiling. Have you guys formally made that request with anybody in the Bureau or any city administrators?
No. We filed the complaint today. The next step will be for the city to answer the complaint. In the Western District, the federal court here, the court sends all of the cases to court. Ordered alternative dispute resolution, and so that would be probably our first opportunity to have those discussions.
How long do they have to respond?
They have 20 days unless they waive service of the complaint, in which case they have 60. So most likely they'll have 60 days.
So Mr. Henderson, you mentioned that you would like to see him off the street for good. Is he off the street now?
We actually don't know where he is, but it sounds like Rich might.
We've heard rumors that he may be assigned to the warrant office, but I have no independent confirmation. That's just our understanding.
Do you know why you were arrested and taken to jail and Mr. Stewart wasn't?
Because I didn't have a press pass on me. and that was the only thing that I heard when we were both sitting there. It was pretty clear as day. They said he's with the media, get him out the handcuffs, and I wasn't with the media, so.
Was he talking back to the officer, though, in the way you were addressing, that your concerns with the officer, could that have been part of?
Actually, no. It was pretty much an order to release Rosano. It wasn't Gromek, you know, saying take him out with cuffs. It was an order to release him because he's with the press.
I think if you look at the complaint, one of the interesting things here is for a stop that seems kind of this innocent, 10 to 15 police officers showed up at the scene, which seems a little bit unusual given the rather bland nature, not for Dennis, but in the wider police sense of what was going on here. This doesn't seem like a huge emergency, and yet 10 to 15 police officers are dispatched to this scene.
Did you hear, Dennis, how he called for backup? Did he make it any...
It was just on his radio, and it was, he might have called for more backup at some point, but he just kind of hit his shoulder when he had told us to walk up on the curb and said he needs backup on Kelly Street. And I don't know if that was the whole SWAT team of cars and dogs and that call, or if he had made another call at some point after arresting us.
Do you think that he was intimidated by the people coming out of that meeting? And that's why he called for backup initially, or that's why he called for more backup?
I have no idea what was going through his head throughout the whole, from the moment he drove upon the scene, I have no idea what was going through his head.
Yeah, the meeting was at the Community Empowerment Association's own building, which you would expect a police officer in that zone to know that that's what that building was for. So, you know, these are community members who are coming together to talk about problems in the community, which we would have expected Officer Gromek to understand, and understand that the people coming out of that building were, you know, community members who, you know, are trying to solve problems, not, you know, I don't know what he thought about people coming out of the building, but he should have known who they were and what they were there for, given that this is part of his patrol.
Did he give you the chance to explain anything about why you were there and what you were doing?
Officer Gromek?
Yeah.
There was never really much dialogue at all from Officer Gromek. I mean, it was more so just orders, and that's about it. There was no conversation. The extent of our conversation was me asking for his badge number and his name, and from there it was pretty much orders directed towards me.
Has there been any explanation as to how or why your driver's license got lost?
Nah, I never got that back. And I did take that as a form of a threat. I mean, from the moment that he told me it was missing, and I don't know how it could have gotten. I mean, it's never came back. Whether it was dropped on the street or another officer grabbed it, or I've never got it back. I don't know how he could have lost it. When I gave him, you know, he requested my ID, I gave him my ID. Once we got down to the station, and they were putting my keys and my phone and everything in the envelope, he was there, and I asked him if he could give them my ID, and he just looked at me and said, I lost it. I left it alone there, but no, I never got any, that never came back. I never received that.
When you asked for his name and badge number, he didn't give those.
He did. He gave his name and badge number, and then as he gave me his name and badge number, he was stepping out the car at the same time and requesting my ID.
Considering the noise that an accelerating vehicle makes, how surprised were you that your exclamation of wow was enough to get him to turn around and, you know, start the whole thing?
Like I said, I can't say what's going through his head, but his quick response, I mean, it was so abrupt that how he turned, it was like he was waiting, he was looking for something. That's just from my observation. When I said, wow, and he turned so quickly, I did realize that it was a problem just how he turned around. Rosano, I will say in Rosano's defense, he when I had asked for the officer's name and badge number, he seen the police officer's face and just the look of the officer. Rosano did say we don't have a problem, and he wanted to leave it alone right there. For me, if you ask me if there's a problem, it's hard for me to just say no, it's not a problem when I did have a problem. And that's where I think my arm may have been twisted a little bit rougher.
Great, well, thank you all for coming, everybody.
Thank you for coming, yeah.
Can I get this spelling of your name?
Sure.